This is Shaji John from Alpha Omega Visual Media. Now we come to the view sense, to see or not see, the moment of eyes. That is very important, sir. That is very important things about while acting. So I try to explain all these things. Almost every art demands some activity of the eyes. For instance, architecture, painting, sculpture, dance, theater, cinema are all visual arts. However, it is very much the same function whether the eyes are in use to look at just anything. Or to appreciate a work of art. The latter experience, the aesthetic experience as it is called, has nothing very mysterious about it. It is first of all a physical experience, an experience of the body. All it requires is a sound, a natural disposition, and a little training. For most people, the training boils down of breaking the ingrained habit of seeing without really seeing. Education is the culprit here. Reading too. To prove this point, a simple test may be undertaken. With this very page, for instance, after reading through, the reader may turn away for an instant and try to recollect the exact shape of the letters just read. Of a certainty, recollection will be down to the minimum. The letters were seen all right. What they said was understood, but their shape did not register due to a lack of interest in this aspect. These have been trained to selective seeing. Another example, one frequently looks at the dial of one's watch. Yet can one describe in detail the figures on the dial, the color of the dial, and so on? Probably not. The habit of seeing only the meaning of things prevents one from noticing the shape they have. Artistic vision, on the contrary, is essentially connected with the perception of shapes. It does not ignore meaning. It discovers meaning in shapes. For it, works of art, meaning and shape are closely connected. Failure to perceive shapes lead to misunderstanding. Hence, it is necessary to look and see properly. Before any headway in art, appreciation can be made. That is why the art of painting is discussed here as a preparation for a study of film. Here is a similar experiment to grasp what has when a person looks at things. Place a coin, a 20 pence one is dial, in the center of a 4 square drawn on sheet of a paper. Position the coin by eye, not by measurement. How does one show that the coin is dead center? A sort of balance, a visual balance ensures this. In order to understand how this sense of balance arises, push the coin towards one side of the square up to about 1/4 from the limit. Now one gets the impression that the coin tends to touch that side. There is no touching of cords. The coin does not move either, and the square remains static. What happens is that while viewing this coin, the eyes that glances in all directions. The various distances are determined by the position of the coin in the square given to the observer, a feeling of tension between the coin and squares. When the tension is balanced, one knows the coin is dead center. When it is not, one gets a feeling of tension on one side. Now, where the coin to be placed in one corner of the square and then another coin placed diagonally opposite, one would feel that something is wrong if the coins be moved towards each other along the diagonal. A place where the two balance each other in a satisfactory way would be discovered. The coin in the square experiment demonstrates that visual perception is basically a record of satisfactory and unsatisfactory experiences, but this is only one aspect of visual perception. A few others shall now be considered. A cursory glance at the painting called A Meeting by the Riverside would suffice to make one realize its ostensible meaning. Radha and Krishna meet at the ghat. There are a few gopis a little apart and a village not too far up. But there is much more to painting than this obvious meaning. One may put aside the meaning for a while and try to view the painting merely as a system of lines and forms. What does one discover? First of all, the beautiful curve formed by the river flowing downwards, that eyes of the onlooker spontaneously follow that curve. All the way from the feet of Krishna, round the gopis and towards the village, thus one gets the sense of a double movement upward and can be a representation of the emotional interrelation between Radha and Krishna. This much is perceived if only one allows oneself to be led by the painting on further scrutiny are discovered suggestive details that enhance the global perception and enhances the picture's mood. For instance, the blue hand of Krishna resting on the dark tree encloses the shape of Radha and Krishna. It also connects this group with the tree itself. On the bark of the tree, a creeper ascends in spiral and blossoms freely. Discreetly. In the branches of the tree, the union of the creeper and the tree is a symbol of love. The creeper is sinuous like the river. In the branches, two birds duplicate the Radha Krishna couple. There are practically no straight lines in pictures, even the houses from a zigzag. The lines, one may say, exude life like the river, the tree, the birds and the lovers. For the assumption of the painter who aims at verisimilitude is the natural lines that are parallel do appear to converge. The meaning of the drawing would then be how a pond surrounded by trees appears to the observer. In the miniature meeting by the riverside, perspective is almost non-existent. Yet a certain sense of depth has been achieved by varying the size of the objects and persons. The artist obviously was not concerned with creating portrait-like realism, but the realism of emotional life. The lack of perspective here, therefore, is not at all a mistake. It only results from a mode of perception that is different from the implied by use of perspective. In fact, perspective in painting is a recent technique. It originated at the time of Renaissance, roughly 14th and 16th centuries. The technique presupposes an almost exclusive emphasis on the use of the eyes in perception, but however important the eyes may be, they are not a man's only organ of perception. A famous theoretician, Marshall McLuhan, condensed that the emphasis on the eye was an effect on the invention of the painting, invention of the printing press. Of course, McLuhan is well aware of the fact that the Italian artist who developed the technique of perspective in painting, like Leonardo da Vinci, were contemporaries of the inventor of the printing press. Johann Gutenberg McLuhan's point is probably, therefore, that the very mentality which led to the invention of the printing device also led to the creation of the technique of perspective. This mentality implies a strong individualism and egocentrism. In other periods of Western history, the relative importance given to the various senses in perception was different. At times, the ear was more important than the eyes. It is observed that nowadays, the ear is one more becoming the main organ of perception. And the masses certainly are indebted to McLuhan, the lonely voice warning them that they now see with their ears the precision of structure. The miniature Rahini Mehamalara of Sahidin, 1628 AD, Neva School of Rajasthani painting, may now be considered with the idea of trying to locate a movement therein. In this miniature, it is easy to observe the movement sweeping from lower left to right, the ascending and turning towards the left once more. As in the first picture studied, the movement again goes upstream. The gopi playing the doll initiates the movement circumscribing Radha and Krishna, who stand motionless in the center as if hypnotized. The direction of the movement and the shapes of the drawing establish a skeleton of the picture which can be preserved in isolation. The drawing itself is divisible into three neat regions: water, earth and sky. The movement takes on as it were a cosmic significance. But there is a striking line cutting across the motif. The doll, the head of Krishna and the peacock, all in the same Krishna blue, create a diagonal that reinforces the circular movement. The four birds duplicate the four human beings, while the two peacocks are evident symbols of Radha Krishna. The golden curves, lightning clouds, match the sinuosity of the river and enliven the sky. The old conception suggests that the gopis, through their celebrating the eternal love of Radha and Krishna, are swept up to the emotional moment beyond the material bounds of the world, right into that otherworldly region where they will dwell forever with the blessed couple they now greet. This description in terms of lines of energy and of skeleton curves is quite a step away from saying that the painting is an image of Radha, Krishna and two gopis, one of whom is playing the doll. If it is worth just that, then any placing or arrangement of the figures would do. In fact, this painting does more than describe a simple action. It communicates the artist's viral reaction to his subject, and the representation has been clothed in symbols that deepen its meaning. It should now be possible to describe what the aesthetic experience that of the creative artist and that of the appreciative spectator consists of.
The painter is steered by a strong motion which he expresses in the very moment of his hands as he paints and outlines his picture. This emotion is evident finally only when the painting is complete. While gazing at the painting, the onlooker responds with his entire person, body, mind. Although it is with his eyes that he perceives the painting, his response arouses within him an emotional and intellectual experience similar to the artist. The experience is said to be similar because the effect of the viewer, human nature being so varied, cannot be identical. For instance, some may contend from their own experience that the artist's feelings were too sentimental or lacking in depth, but it is more likely, especially while viewing the works of great masters, that a lesson is feeling with a greater subtlety or self-control will be derived. Next, about expression. From what has been said so far about the precision of shapes, structures and energies in paintings, it appears that what is first perceived in all image is not its meaning or shape, but the meaning of its shape. That is the expression. Expression is way things look, sad or happy, friendly or hostile. All shapes and structures are discussed in the foregoing paragraphs convey expression of feeling. But since pictorial expression cannot be translated into words too accurately, it was necessary to first emphasize the power of patterns and designs to convey such expression. Should a man in tears be asked why he is weeping, he would probably answer that he is sad. This is not quite correct. A man weeps because of some unpleasant incident, and because he weeps, he is sad. This is not a sort of playing with words. Even the ancient Bharata Muni raised the same question in Natya Shastra. His point was that through a correct representation with the help of words, gestures, postures and decor, it was possible for one to evoke an emotion or a rasa in oneself or in a specter. Modern psychology would fully agree, for instance, when one is sad. One may cheer oneself up by whistling. The way a painting is arranged, then its expression, one perceives expression in painting through experiencing lines, shapes, and masses. A famous art scholar has written, "Our senses are not self-contained recording devices operating for their own sake. They have been developed by the organism as an aid in properly reacting to the environment. The organism is primarily interested in the forces that are active around it. Their place, strength, direction, hostility and friendliness are attributes of forces, and the perceived impact of forces makes for what we call expression. By way of summarizing all that has been deduced so far, it will be useful to make a look at one more painting, Lamentation, picture by Giotto, dating from about 1305 AD. What strikes the viewer first in this painting is the extraordinary expression of grief and sorrow on the faces of both the people surrounding the dead body of Christ and the angels in the sky. But the painting is expressive in many other ways too. Graphically, there is some similarity between the Lamentation and the Ragini Malara, which was studied above for the angels in the sky and the people on the earth from a circle. There is also a diagonal here, formed by rather odd rod. There is a difference, however, between this painting and the Rajasthani miniature. The circular lines no longer set a moment. All is centered on Christ, although Christ's body is lifeless. It is lifted so as not to lie inert on the ground. Dumps are held in the direction of the diagonal rod. The empty space between Christ and the man standing with the arms outstretched calls for an ascensional movement towards the tree along the road. Both the tree and road emphatically lack realism. This is in marked contrast to the people who look so real. In fact, both the tree and road have symbolic meanings. The tree is at one end of the road, at the other end is Christ, ready as it were to rise towards the tree. The tree is a symbol of life. Its branches extend in all directions and even outside the frame of the picture. Thus, these objects stand as a symbol of Christ rising from the dead and vanishing into an immaterial world. These figures on the left form a circle, excluding the last two figures on the right. The two men standing separately have a much more serene expression than the others. They stand below the tree of life. They seem to have rooted their faith in Christ. The man with the outstretched arms who stands in the middle graphically associates them with the circle of mourners. But the color of their vestments is in contrast with that of the vestments the others wear. Thus, the two are made to participate in the sorrow of the others, though they are not quite identified with them. The immediate impact of death may be grief and sorrow, but there is the promise of the next life. The ascensional moment along the diagonal is kept in balance by the heaviness of the masses on the left, and the ethereal quality of the tree on the right hand and side. This is about the movement of eyes. Next, we come to the definition of a feeling. An appearance of a continuous motion created by motionless images. What is a feeling? A ridiculous question. One might say, everyone knows what a feeling is, too, but try to formulate a definition of feeling. Is it an art? Is it just moving pictures or filmed theater? To answer these questions, a discussion of a short excerpt from Satyajit Ray's Pather Panchali will be made. One studied portrait or drama through the works of great poets and dramatists. One comes to know all passages by heart. The same method can be employed in the study of feeling. The passage now taken for study is the portion in the film where Durga and Appu, the brother and sister, see a candyman and follow him to neighbor's house. A part of a feeling complete in itself is called a sequence, and it corresponds to a chapter in a book. For greater convenience, the passage under study will be termed the candyman sequence. The candyman sequence, the spectator sees that one day Durga had a prepared pickles for Appu and herself, and suddenly she is pleasantly surprised by the familiar sound of a bell and so on. Generally, the first function of cinema is to tell things, cinema being a sort of language. If one runs the sequence, not in movie projector, but in slide projector, slowly pulling the film along in front of the lens, one will notice that the film is made up of smart photos, each very similar to the ones which precede and follow it. Each of these photos is called a frame. None of the frames is a moving picture. It is only when the images are projected one by one on the screen at a certain speed that the film made of still pictures takes on the life of a movie, one can pull the Candyman sequence in a slide projector as fast as one wishes. A moving picture will not be obtained. Only a blurred image will appear. The movie projector shows the frames of the film one by one, but without showing the film as it moves in front of the lens, by means of a mouse pocket holes, the film celluloid is directed in front of an aperture the size of a frame and through which the light passes. A shutter prevents the light from passing during the fraction of a second when one frame replaces a previous one in front of the aperture. The light is made to pass through that aperture only when the film is static. In effect, 24 frames are flashed successively on the screen in 1 second, and 24 times the screen is dark to allow the film's movement. But the eyes retain only the luminous impressions. The successive still images pile up, as it were, and the difference between one and the next is perceived as a moment. How it is possible for a succession of still images to appear as one continuous moving image has to do with the psychology of human vision. Whatever this may be, it appears that cinema is first of all the experience of a continuous moment, which moment is artificial and exists only in the mind. For it is the mind that supplies the continuum required for all the separate pictures to merge into an apparently real moment. Cinema can thus be considered from the point of view of the mechanical, optical or photographic elements which constitute the film used in a projector. But cinema can also be considered from the point of view of the person watching the film in terms of that person's experience. In this book's film world, Ivor Montagu has touched upon both aspects when he wrote that cinema is an appearance of continuous motion created in the mind of the observer by presentation of a series of motionless images in rapid sequence. In practice, rapid sequence means that 60 or 24 such motionless images are thrown on the screen in 1 second, according to whether the film is a movie, 60 images, or a total 24 images that have been arranged in an appropriate succession. Now, to return to the Candyman sequence, one would find that the all length of the sequence is made up of several clearly identifiable series of images or frames. There are places where two consecutive frames are markedly different. One frame is the last of a series of almost similar images. The following one is the first of the new series. Such series are called shots. Passing the Candyman sequence through a slide projector, one finds that it is contains nearly 40 series or shots. While this succession of frames generates the appearance of motion, the succession of shots creates meaning and rhythm. Thus, one should be able to identify each shot composing the whole sequence as follows. Durga looking at Appu says, "You won't tell mother, won't you?" Second, Appu is given some of the pickles, makes a noise, gets a slap. Durga scores him. Appu looks at Durga's hands, making the mistake. 5. Durga takes some of it. 6. Appu eats and smiles. 7. Durga eats slowly and smiles. 8. Appu receives some more smiles. A bell is heard faintly. 9. Durga takes some more. She hears the bell, rises, goes towards an opening in the wall, peeps through the wall. 10. Through the aperture, man is seen walking at some distance. It is possible to carry on jotting down what each thought reveals, but such an analysis has no literary quality, and book written in similar way would be dull. Yet the film, with its succession of shots, is most captivating. In fact, the 40 shots flow in a pleasing succession. The film jumps, as it were, from Durga's face to Apu's without the spectator experiencing any difficulty to understand. In the case of the frame succession, it is the viewer who provides the continuum or background required for experiencing a moment. In the case of the short succession, the viewer again supplies the background in which the shots complement each other to create meaning. Thus, even when one is most passive while watching a film, one is made to contribute to it much more than one believes. The process of arranging the shots in a proper sequence is generally called editing, and it will be discussed later. The following questions now arises. Where does the filmmaker get the suitable shots from? The whole film is not photographed in the succession. If one observes on the screen, the film is made shot by shot in the order most practical. From the point of view of locations or studio of actors, the following questions now arises. When does the filmmaker get the suitable shots from? The whole film is not photographed in the succession, which one observes on the screen. The film is made shot by shot in the order most practical. From the point of view of the location or studio of actors and of camera requirements, the filmmaker usually knows at the time of taking a shot how we'll use it in combination with the preceding and following shots. After the shooting is over, he dreams the shots to correct the length and fastens them together. Since editing requires a lot of cutting, the process is also called cutting, and the filmmaker must shoot cut, that is, photograph the shots so as to be able to edit them together. So as to produce fiction out of reality, the process of making a film demands of the filmmaker the ability to dream his film as it were. Before or at the time he makes it, cinema is at a particular language whereby the filmmaker shares his dreams with the audience. Cinema has the unique power to lead the audience on in a sort of dream, leaving a very little freedom with regard to the particulars of that dream. For instance, one who reads the novel Padar Panchali by Bithu Bhushan Banerjee can picture Apu. He features his manner of talking. But in the film, Apu has a definite characteristics and nothing is left for the imagination. In this respect, subsequently in this book, when camera work is discussed, the many ways in which the filmmaker directs his dream will be explained. However, as an example, the first 9 shots of the Candyman sequence may be considered. These are photographs of faces looking at each other. The photographs were taken by placing the camera almost at the level of Durga's and Apu's heads. This gives the feeling of being intimately associated with them at their little banquet. Had the camera been higher, one would have had the feeling of observing them from outside, as it were, or even of looking down at the children's game.
What permits the filmmaker to direct the viewer's dreams is also that which constantly challenges his skill and creativity. The realism of photographic image, the filmmaker must wrestle with the reality to make it represent his dream. The extent to which the filmmaker controls reality determines entire film. The filmmaker must wrestle the extent to which the filmmaker controls reality reality determines the extent to which he can create fiction. Thus, the Candyman sequence, which it looks absolutely real, is pure fiction. To sum up, cinema is an appearance of continuous motion created by motionless images, which have been arranged in an appropriate succession so as to produce a fiction out of reality. In fact, cinema covers the range of all films taken collectively. This is includes a large number of films which at times have a little in common, yet each is an appearance of a continuous moment. To sum up, cinema is an appearance of continuous motion created by motionless images, which have been arranged in an appropriate succession so as to produce a fiction out of reality.
This is Shaji John from Alpha Omega Visual Media signing off.